subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Ganymede is the largest moon in the solar system and it orbits Jupiter. It is in fact so large in size that it is larger than the planet Mercury. It is also the most massive moon in the solar system, although it is not more massive than Mercury. Last week, NASA's spacecraft Juno, that is currently in orbit around Jupiter, made its closest approach to Ganymede on the 7th of June. NASA has since released Juno's high-resolution pictures taken off Ganymede's surface, and these are gorgeous. They show craters, they show light and shadows on the varying kinds of dark and light terrain, and they even show what look like tectonic faults. In this video, let's discuss the magnificent Ganymede. What do we know about it, what Juno is finding out about it, and why this massive moon in the solar system is so interesting to us, and if it is habitable. I'm Sandhya Ramesh and this is Pure Science. Jupiter has a total of 79 moons and Ganymede is its biggest and most massive. Its orbit is the seventh innermost from Jupiter. There is Metis, Adrastea, Amalthea and Thebe, the innermost four moons, and then there are the four Galilean moons, Io, Europa, Ganymede and Callisto in that order. Galilean moons were discovered and observed in modern history, first by Galileo in 1609 when he refined the telescope. But actually, one of the two, either Ganymede or Callisto, was observed by the ancient Chinese astronomer called Ganda in 365 to 364 BCE. He was actually the first person to compile a star catalog in all of history, and he was known for his observations of Jupiter, but with the naked eye. In 1610, Galileo published his observations, which were the first documented meticulous observations of the four largest moons of Jupiter, and they were called Galilean moons. Coincidentally, a German astronomer named Simon Marius independently discovered these four moons the very day after Galileo did with his telescope, because of course telescope was the newest hottest thing at the time. Marius proposed some names for these four moons, and once again just ridiculous names. He wanted to name these four moons the Saturn of Jupiter, the Jupiter of Jupiter, which would have been Ganymede, the Venus of Jupiter and the Mercury of Jupiter. But then Kepler made some suggestions to him and Marius revised the names he had and based new ones on Greek mythology, which is what all planets and moons are named after, except for Uranus's moons. Marius then described Ganymede as the handsome son of King Tros, whom Jupiter transported on his back when he had taken the form of an eagle. As with all Jupiter's moons, Ganymede was also a lover of Jupiter and is the only Galilean moon with a male name. The eight planets and their moons in the solar system are named after characters in the Greek and Roman mythology, except for Uranus's moons, which are named after characters in Shakespeare. Jupiter is the Roman god of sky and thunder, and in Greek mythology, his equivalent is Zeus. In Hindu mythology, he is similar to Indra. In Norse mythology, he is similar to Thor. But all of these characters are different. Jupiter and Zeus are the same. Now, if you're unfamiliar with Greek or Latin mythology, basically, Jupiter was extremely lustful. He would want to seduce anything that moved. So, he had lots of lovers. Juno, the mission to Jupiter, was named after Jupiter's wife and the mother of Mars. NASA described this as the god Jupiter drew a veil of clouds around himself to hide his mischief with all of his lovers, and the goddess Juno was able to peer through the clouds and reveal Jupiter's true nature. So that is what Juno has set out to do. Ganymede orbits Jupiter at a distance of over 1 million kilometers. It's tidally locked to Jupiter, just like most moons are locked to their host bodies in the solar system. which means that there is only one side of Ganymede that faces Jupiter, just like there's only one side of the moon that we can see from Earth. Ganymede is also in orbital resonance with the other moons Europa and Io. For every orbit that Ganymede completes around Jupiter, Europa does 2 orbits and Io does 4 orbits. Ganymede, as we saw earlier, is the largest and most massive moon in the solar system. It is made up of rocky material and water ices, and there's also a large subsurface or underground liquid water ocean. We've already seen in previous videos about why water is so appealing to us, and whenever there is a subsurface ocean of liquid water, we do get very excited and we think that such a body could potentially be habitable. Water ice is in fact everywhere on Ganymede's surface, and there are also other compounds and salts on the surface, such as those of carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide, and even some organic compounds. The reflectivity or surface albedo of Ganymede is a bit weird. One part, one hemisphere is very bright while the other hemisphere is not. The surface of the moon is made up of two types of terrain. There's the older surface that is highly cratered and the regions tend to be darker, while the younger terrain is higher and it also has a lot of grooves but very few craters. The darker parts of the terrain are also very interesting because these contain clays and other organic material that we tend to mostly find on the Earth-Mars side of the solar system. And these materials can actually hold clues to the composition of these giant bodies that collided and crashed and impacted with each other and became debris around Jupiter to eventually accrete and form Ganymede itself. The newer terrain is somewhat of a mystery. For grooves to appear on an icy surface, there needs to be some form of a heat source. It is thought that this was likely to be tectonic. Jupiter's moons also experience high amounts of tidal forces from all of the flexing that they undergo when being pulled by both Jupiter as well as the other massive moons all around. So this causes a lot of geological activity inside these moons because of tidal forcing, such as in the case of Io, which is the most volcanically active body in our solar system and is a moon of Jupiter that is caught between the gravitational pull of Callisto, Europa, Ganymede, and also Jupiter. Ganymede internally is also fully differentiated, which means that it has an iron-nickel core. Ganymede internally is also fully differentiated, which means, like a planet, it has an iron-nickel core. Internally, Ganymede is also fully differentiated, which means that it has an iron-nickel core, it has a silicate mantle, and it has an outer crust that is made of water ices as well as liquid water. The subsurface ocean, of course, indicates potential habitability and is very exciting astrobiologically. Also extremely interesting is Ganymede's magnetic field and magnetosphere. The Galileo spacecraft that made flybys of Ganymede from about 1995 to 2000 discovered that Ganymede also had a magnetic field on its own, which was distinct from Jupiter's magnetic field. Jupiter's magnetic field is the largest in the solar system, of course, apart from the sun's, and it tends to trail behind the planet, enveloping other moons. So Ganymede actually interestingly has a smaller magnetosphere inside that of Jupiter's own magnetosphere. It is in fact the only known moon that we know with this feature. Many spacecraft have flown past Ganymede. The first one was Pioneer 10 in 1973. The Voyagers and even the New Horizons also studied Ganymede, but these all observed Ganymede from far away distances. Galileo and Juno have been the only two spacecraft to observe the moon very close up because both of them have been in orbit around Jupiter. In the future, the Jupiter Icy Moon Explorer or the JUICE mission will be the first to enter orbit around Ganymede itself directly. It is a European mission and ESA is expected to launch it in June of 2022. It will fly by the moon in 2029 first before entering into orbit in 2032. It is expected to function for 2 years because there is intense radiation near and around Jupiter and Ganymede. And after 2 years, it's expected to crash into Jupiter. It can't crash into Ganymede because Ganymede contains water and ices and we cannot contaminate the moon. The photos of Ganymede that are being released right now were taken by Juno Cam, which is a camera on Juno, which is used for public outreach. More pictures are expected to come in soon, and NASA is expected to release even more high-resolution portraits of Ganymede in the coming days.